So let me, I'll give you a word of how I got into this problem. Amit Sur is here, who's there when we both got into this problem. It really came from, an article written by Martin Raff. It was sort of the last piece of work he did before he retired. He's an immunologist from the UK. And he had done some experiments. They were kind of funny experiments, but he sort of argued that this whole notion of size regulation, which had been around for a while, was really kind of nonsense, because all size regulation was growth regulation and cell cycle regulation. And these were two independent processes, and the result of a certain amount of growth divided by how quickly you divide ends up as a resultant in size. And Martin, if any of you know him, very clear speaking, thoughtful person, challenging, likes to challenge existing ideas. I wondered if he was right. And so that got me interested in the problem do cells measure size? How do they control size? And this is a problem which turned out to be difficult to study for the oddest reason you could think of. And that is, it's difficult to measure the size of cells, seems to me it's the easiest thing to see. I've showed you a big cell and a little cell. You can tell them apart. It's not like in this era where we can measure transcriptomes and individual cells, talk about size being a difficult thing to measure. But it's hard to measure it accurately, and in order to understand what's going on, you have to understand it, you have to measure it accurately. So we started out to look at this problem, and we're not that far, but I think we've understood it to the point of knowing where there is size regulation, maybe when it occurs. The first thing is, size regulation something we should be thinking about? And of course, cells double in size each cell cycle. And they have to maintain that cell size roughly. And if you look at normal tissues, you often find that they are, I guess you have two screens here. So it's going to be kind of interesting.
One is experiment, the other is control.
okay, all right. I'll alternate which screen I use. Each person will get half the information, and you can talk about it later. If you look at normal cells here in a simple epithelium, they look like they're all about the same size. If you look at cells often in a tumor, you see that they're really quite different in size. So size regulation seems to fail in tumor cells, at least in some tumors. It's one of those elusive integrative concepts. I mean, it obviously has something to do with cell growth. It has something to do with cell division. And we don't know whether cells actually measure their size or whether they're just very accurately keeping the two things going at the same rate. So that's sort of the question. Now, here's two models of how cells grow, extreme models. One model is that they grow in mass linearly with time. That is, every 10 minutes, they add a certain X amount of mass, and then that just keeps going on and on, in which case the growth in mass is constant with time, and the mass increases linearly. The other possible model, these are simple models, is that cells grow exponentially. That is, the bigger they are, the more ribosomes they have, the more everything else they have, so they grow faster and faster. The growth of mass is proportional, increases with time. Okay. Or it might be more like human beings. If you look at growth during a human being's development, it's neither linear nor exponential. There's a lot of fast growth that occurs early on, and then it slows down, and then just before puberty it decreases, and then jumps up again, and it comes down, I'm not talking about people just adding adiposity. Of course, that's another aspect. I'm talking about lean mass of growth, and it has this kind of funny thing. So maybe cells in the cell cycle do the similar thing. They have some sort of function that is not linear, it's not exponential, it's something else. Now, the problem in measurement is just to just give you an idea here, is if you had something that doubled in size versus exponentially, it doubled in size linearly, the largest difference in cell size at any point in this process of doubling would be 6%. So if the cell were spherical, that would be a 2% difference in diameter. And it came again kind of a surprise to me as I got into reading about this field that there were all these sort of models and thoughtful and biophysical people in the sort of 1960s and maybe earlier, some early 70s as well, who basically concluded they couldn't distinguish these two models because the microscopy wasn't accurate enough. Too much spherical aberration, y-axis measurements weren't very good, cells weren't completely round. And that came as a complete surprise to me that there's something as simple to measure, you would think, as cell size would be, in fact, too inaccurate to measure to distinguish these two very different models of cell growth. Now, so that led to looking for better ways of measuring it. Now, when I talk about size, there are many things one could talk about, and they can easily all be measured. But what I really, for the rest of this talk, talking about cell mass. And I'm actually talking about protein mass, which is most of the cell mass. So it's the dry mass of the protein. That is, if you were to take a cell, dehydrate it, get rid of all the ions, not worry about the carbohydrate and fat, you could study those independently. We can do that, as I'll show you. But protein mass is the thing I'm talking about. Those are things that are connected with ribosomes. Those are things you might think are connected somehow with mTOR or some other pathways that people love to study. So at least that was the thing we were using. So we've actually pushed and collaborated with and helped develop, in some cases, several methods which enable us to make these measurements accurately and to answer these questions. One is a method which was developed in part by a woman who came to my lab as a postdoc from MIT, an optical physicist, called quantitative phase microscopy. It's basically a form of interferometry. And for those of you who are physically inclined, it really measures essentially the refractive index differences. Some through the thickness of the cell and integrated over the whole cell. And refractive index is actually very insensitive to compositional changes. It's not even all that difference between a gram of carbon and a gram of oxygen. They have the same, almost the same refractive increment per mass. Even uranium and carbon, I mean, they're different enough, but not all that different. And the reason is that refractive index measures an amount of polarizable electrons, which is kind of a reflection of the number of protons, the number of, in a nucleus as well, which is sort of a function of mass. So it turns out we probably, it's the one measurement we would think would be insensitive to changes in molecular composition. The second method was developed at MIT, and we worked with him as well, with Scott Manalis, and some of you may know him. He took upon the challenge of weighing a cell. Now it turns out that engineers like to have challenges, and one challenge out there that I didn't know about was weighing the lightest thing. The lightest thing that's been weighed is about 1 zeptogram. A zeptogram is 10 to the minus 21 grams. So we have one polypeptide of 6,000 molecular weight, one protein, one single one, you could put on this machine and measure its mass. The way it's done, and I'll come to it in a way, is he developed a modification allowing you to do it with cells. We don't measure zeptograms, but we can measure cells. And this is still the most accurate method available. We can measure the mass of a cell using his method to plus or minus 1/100 of 1%. Enough to tell a lot of things, but it's limited to cells that are suspended. Another method was developed by a person from the Weizmann primarily, called ergodic rate analysis, and Amit was also involved in this as well. And it's a very accurate method. It tells us something very important. There's ambiguity in what we get out of it. An interesting ambiguity, a very well-defined ambiguity, which I think means we can't use it alone, but we use it a lot. And then another method is, which I'll mention, is stimulated Raman microscopy, spectroscopy, which, okay. So I'll start out with this fluorescent, with this SMR method developed by Scott Manalis's group. And here, the way this zeptogram thing was done is you have a cantilever, which is like a rod held rigidly at one end, which is induced to vibrate in almost a very high vacuum by an electric field. And the frequency of that vibration depends on the mass of the rod. And you put your zeptogram weight on the end of this cantilever, changes the mass by a little bit. And you can measure the frequency is almost up to megahertz of vibration. You can measure that with a laser. You just count the number of, so you get that very accurately. You can count those things. So with that, you can count the zeptogram. The problem with that is putting a cell in almost a perfect vacuum is not the best condition under which to watch cell growth. And so, what Scott Manalis did in the initial part of his work was to build out of silicon a cantilever here, which uses rod tape thing, but he built it with a channel inside it. And then he could take a cell and pass it through this channel, basically pump it through this channel, and the cell would displace the water, of course, of its volume. So you got the buoyant weight of this material that went in there, and he could count the number of vibrations, and you can measure the mass very accurately. And we could also use a fluorescence detector using Fucci dyes, which will allow us to measure the position of the cell cycle. We could know the position of the cell cycle, and we could watch these cells grow over, 8 different generations and get very accurate growth rates, and didn't affect the rate compared to what it was in just in culture medium. It isn't culture medium, but the vibration doesn't seem to bother the cell at all. And from that, we could learn finally something that we could believe. It's clearly not growing linearly at a constant rate over time, but it's growing something more like an exponential rate. But exponential rate would be, if you took the growth rate as a function of mass, so exponential would mean that the dmdt, or so the increment versus time, would be proportional to mass. And you can see it's more complicated than that. It grows the growth rate increases kind of linearly for a while, and then it stops, slows down, and it does a funny few things and comes on again. So there's something more complicated going on.
Average over many cells?
Pardon?
This is average over many cells?
No, this is one cell. Or average it over many cells. Yeah. Yeah. So importantly, in these measurements, the coefficient of variation, which should increase as the cells increase in mass, actually decreases at one point in the cell cycle. And that tells us something very interesting is going on. Now it has to decrease, because if it were just if the cells were just growing exponentially, then the mass was increasing. The coefficient of variation would double. It should double over when the doubling of the cell. So for it not to double, there has to be a way, and it doesn't, because if you grow cells in culture for generation after generation, the average size and the variance in the size that remains constant. So something is going on that's telling the cell to not increase its variation, which it would if it were growing proportional to its size. Well, that may take a little explanation. When cells divide, they don't divide absolutely equally. So you have a small cell and a larger cell. And if we're growing proportional to size, the larger cell would grow faster than the smaller cell. And this would, over time, cause the variance to increase over time. And this doesn't happen. And in fact, during the cell cycle of one cell, a population of cells, the coefficient of variation drops and then increases again, and eventually remains constant over the time of cell division. Okay, so this just seems that the option that was proposed, that cell growth by Martin Raff, that there was independent growth of cell growth and cell cycle, is not an option. Just the nonlinearity in the growth rate, as the dependence of growth on mass, implies a need for size detection and mechanisms and size control mechanisms. Because I said if we were dividing by exponentially, they should become more and more diverse in the population. The cell size should be diverse in the population. Similarly, the decrease in the coefficient of variation as the cell grows can only be explained by a mechanism of growth or cell cycle progression that distinguishes between large and small cells. So that tells us somehow a cell must know how big it is and do something about it. Okay, so there are two general ways we can think of by which a cell can do something about it. It can adjust its cell cycle length. So let's say we have two cells that are growing in the population, and one of them is a big cell and one of them is a small cell. The big cell could divide more quickly because it's bigger. It would be a size threshold. And it could exit, say, G1 and go through that last step of the cell cycle. Whereas the small cell could grow until it reached a certain size threshold. And then it could divide. And then in the end, you would have cells of the same size. So that's one possibility. Another possibility is a growth rate adjustment. At some point, cells might look at themselves and say, I need to go, I need to eat more or whatever, I need to get larger. And so a small cell would change its growth rate at some point. To compensate for its size, they would divide at the same time, but they would then be the same size. So the answer that we now know is that both occur in somatic mammalian cells. Probably the dominant one is the growth rate adjustment and not the size threshold. Okay. So the first really approach, and there's been a history in this field in my lab in opening up these problems, not completely, but of important Israeli scientists who come to my lab and make a contribution. Amit Sur, who is here at Bar-Ilan University, was the first, and Ron Coffrey, who developed this ergodic rate analysis, was the second. This is done by a woman who spent time in both the United States and in Israel, so her family lives in both places, Miriam Ginsberg. There's very careful experiments which opened up this question, but there, we don't actually, it makes a big assumption. She used nuclear size as a surrogate for cell size, because you could measure that easily. And she found that there was the G1 length, this is that there was some effect, This is versus if you plotted the G1 length, that is the time in G1 is a function of nuclear size at birth, the larger the cell, the shorter the G1 length. So as I say, there is a characteristic of this where there is a where the is a some sort of threshold of size, that is, the bigger cells will have a shorter G1 and therefore compensate for their size. And so, okay, but that's only half the story. So as I say, cell size is really a product of the time a cell grows, which is sort of a cell cycle length, and the rate at which cell cycle grows. And as I say, both are regulated, but the more interesting of them, for me, my point of view, because it's the largest effect, and it's the one which is hardest to explain, is that it's the rate of cell cycle growth which is modulated by the cell. So big cells grow, they grow bigger, faster for a while, and they grow slower for a while, and they compensate based on their rate of growth. Okay, so let's look at some of this data. So if we look at mean size over time in a population, we can see that it isn't, you know, there's this dip here where mean size stops growing at the same rate it was growing. And you can do this by time-lapse microscopy. If you look at the variance in cell size, the variance increases, then decreases, and then increases again. This is all Miriam Ginsberg's work. And you can see that, I mean, this is what it looks like. At this point here, where there's a minimum in variance, you can see that the population is distributed over a smaller range. And then, of course, it increases the length, again, the length. So this is really puzzling. What's happening here? Why do cells now change their growth rate depending on how big they are? So, let's say we conclude that there's a cell size sensor and that it affects cell cycle progression to inhibit cell size, and it affects cell growth rate to inhibit cell size. Okay, so for the most part, cells can regulate both. And if you look at some data of the mean growth rate as mean cell cycle length, you get a contour, which is true for cells in the population. And if you start perturbing it with drugs, this contour is the contour that maintains cell size. So as you perturb it with drugs, you don't get the effects that you might expect. For example, putting cyclohexaban cells will slow down the mean growth rate, but will also increase the mean cell cycle length. So actually, cell size doesn't vary very much at all. And you can do all sorts of drugs. You can put on there rapamycin, taurine, CDK inhibitors. They all most tend to fall along this general iso cell size contour, where size and cell cycle length are being perturbed in a reciprocal manner. Okay. So now I want to really come back, really focus on this period in which cell growth variation and cell growth is used to decrease the variation in the size in the population, and to understand a little bit how that's working. And as I said, this has been mostly an exercise in measurement, and that's kind of where we are. I think we have come clear to our understandings about what's going on, but we don't know the underlying mechanism. But I think we're in a position now to be able to get at the underlying mechanism. So this was a real breakthrough, this approach of ergodic rate analysis by Ron Coffrey. So he basically said, well, look, can we, using a static image, calculate, make dynamic measurements in a population. This is a very general problem, very useful general technique. So in, as you probably know if you study physical chemistry, looking at the a Boltzmann distribution and looking at the velocity of the molecules at in the population at any given moment, you can predict, the ergodic theorem says that that velocity distribution will be what a given molecule will achieve over time. So that the behavior of a single molecule over time will be reflected in the variation in molecules at any given time in the population. And so you can do all sorts of calculations about thermodynamic things from single static measurements of many, many different molecules. So the idea was, is if you had a population steady state, it makes two assumptions, that you have a steady state, which is easy to demonstrate because you can just measure it once and you can measure it 2 hours later, and if nothing's changed, it's steady state. And that there's an average behavior of the cell, and its trajectory equals the spatial average of the population at any one time point. With that assumption, you can measure parameters and calculate trajectories in the following way. So here we have two cell cycle parameters, geminin, which is a protein which starts accumulating late in G1 and is degraded abruptly in mitosis after anaphase, and DNA content, which doubles in the cell cycle during S phase. And you can make those measurements using the Fucci method, but here we're just using one of the Fucci dyes. And each of the dots here represents a cell. So every cell here has a level of geminin, a level of DNA, and you can see geminin increases here and through G1, and then DNA doubles and geminin continues to increase. And the density at each stage in this graph represents the speed in which things are going through the cell cycle. So if you find things that a very high density part of this graph here, that means there are lots of cells there. That means they're going slowly through this point in the process. If you have a very low density, for example, metaphase itself, where the chromosomes suddenly separate and the geminin is degraded, there are very few cells here. And that means that's going very rapidly through that process. So you get from the density of the population at any given time, you get a measure of the speed in which it's occurring. Okay, so we can measure the cell cycle. We can also measure simultaneously mass with DNA, with a protein dye. We can measure phosphorylation of AKT or anything you want. Anything can be placed on this, and you get a very accurate dynamic measurement of how things are changing in the cell cycle at a single image. Now, to get accurate measurements, you have to measure lots of cells, and typically we measure about 1 million cells, so it means a lot of image processing. There's, of course, errors in measurement, if anybody's done immunofluorescence or those kinds of things. But those errors of measurement tend to be random, and they go down sort of as the square root of the number of objects you're looking at. So if you look at enough objects, you get very accurate data. And we proved that it works by looking at a lot of direct time-lapse measurements of geminin versus time, and then the red thing I put on there is the calculation of fixed L. So, and then we've done this. It's extremely accurate, extremely reproducible, extremely easy to do. Okay, so what do we see with, we can actually measure growth rate because we can measure mass at any different point. Therefore, we can measure difference of mass over this trajectory. That gives us growth rate, mass increases. And we see at G1 and also later on at S phase, where these zeros are these dips and that occur in the growth rate. So the growth rate is kind of constant for a while. Then it goes down, then it goes up, and it flattens out, goes up in HeLa cells and other types of cells. So what are we looking for? Well, remember, if it were linear growth, the growth rate would be constant over time. And we can express that by this formula here, which would be, you know, a growth rate formula. So if alpha were zero, that would be constant growth rate. So the MDT would just equal to k. We could have single exponential, simple exponential growth would be proportional mass, that would be here. We could have some sort of complex feedback where alpha would be a function of cell cycle time. And these are the kinds of data we get. Again, it's very reproducible data. These are the mouse lymphocytes that we looked at or by the SMR measurements of the vibrating cantilever, and we see this big drop in this parameter alpha around G1 and these sorts of things happening in human fibrosarcoma cells. We also see a similar thing at G1. And in HeLa cells, we see two. And we've looked at other cell types. Most cell types we look at, we see two drops. So, and these drops, this is non-trivial. This suddenly goes from something that is kind of linear growth, or in this case, it's exponential growth, it's more linear growth, something we can understand, to this huge sudden situation where over here, the bigger you are, the faster you grow, and then suddenly, the bigger you are, the slower you grow. Okay, so what do these mean? And as I say, the growth rate at this time of transition decreases as cell size increases. And we see these transitions both in G1 and in S phase. So, okay. Well, we're very excited and very happy with ergodic rate analysis and it took us a while, frankly, to realize the ambiguity in our measurement. Now, remember what we're doing here. We're basically taking cells and stretching them, each individual cell, so it fits the cell cycle interval. And then we're measuring the level of their protein or level mass over time in that interval, or some other parameter in that interval. So we can see a change in DMDT, and you know, as I said, the data is very clear. I mean, that we're we can see these changes in DMDT. Oops, I don't have any trouble here. It's not. Yeah, we can see these changes in DMDT that look very real and reproducible. But we don't know whether mass is changing or time is changing. So what I mean by that is we're stretching the things to fit a given time. It could be that DMDT is increasing because the cell cycle is decreasing. Or it could be that the mass is increasing and the cell cycles remain constant. So this is a fundamental ambiguity in the measurement. You can't get around it. And so to further interpret it, we have to make real-time measurements, dynamic measurements. It's a wonderful way of correlating events in the cell cycle. It's a wonderful way of getting very accurate measurements of something which is related to what we're interested in, but it doesn't tell us whether the cell cycle is changing or the rate of mass increases changing. So that brought us to a need for a real-time measurement, and we're particularly interested in attached cells, cells that are growing on a substratum, that we can make accurately, that directly reflects mass. And so this is a method brought by this woman, Sunyun Oh from MIT. It's called quantitative phase microscopy, and what we're measuring is the change in refractive index spatially, and then measuring it over time. And we have a wave front, we have a regular wave of cells. We have a light beam which contains light waves that are coming through. We have a wave front that are going through the cell, and as it goes through the cell, it gets retarded by the mass, and we're measuring this retardation. And from that, we'll be able to calculate the dry mass because we're subtracting the fluid. It's really an interferometer, so it's really measuring the difference in optical path length through the fluid versus through the cell. You can think of it that way. It's a single beam approach we're using, but if you thought it was a double beam approach, you think one beam is going through the fluid and one beam is going through the cell, and then they're recombined, and from that you can measure the refractive index. And that's a direct measure of mass. So that turns out to be the tool that breaks this whole problem open. So we had to do a lot of processing on the images. This is quite at the limit of the precision that this method could be used, but we finally can get things that look like that. And we can measure cells growing here. They're starting at G1. And you'll see that they turn on germinin late in G1. You see that beginning to turn on. And so we have cell cycle, and we have cell mass from this optical path delay. And we have what we need to actually make real-time mass measurements. Okay, so then we typically take the cells. We grow them for 2 hours. We can measure over time, but we just take two different time points to start with, at least one which is here, and then the next one which is a little later, say 2 hours later. We fix, and then we stain with DAPI to measure DNA content. So then we have, and also to measure germinin expression. So we have our standard plot here, plotted upside down from the last one. And we can measure, as these cells go through this plot, the individual cells, we can measure their mass directly. So here we see, if we measure the DNA content in a cell that's going through this process, the DNA content starts here, and then DNA synthesis occurs, and it goes up about doubles during this time. And if we're looking at germinin, that dye to tell us where it is in the cell cycle, germinin turns on, as you see, in G1, and then increases until mitosis, but we don't watch it that long. Now, here we're measuring the growth rate of cells versus the cell cycle. And this is time. This is the cell cycle stage. And you can see that the growth rate increases, and then it goes through this dip again, which we mentioned at G1. And increases again, and it goes through this dip, which we in S phase. So the two times in the growth of these HeLa cells that the cell cycle corrects itself, that is the average growth rate slows down. And if you look at the coefficient of variation in mass, you see it going up and then coming down again in this phase, going up again and coming down again. And in the end, the coefficient of variation doesn't change very much from the initial time point. So it's all these corrections that are going on which keep the coefficient of variation constant in the end. So cell size is controlled by adjusting growth rate. We can see that it's a small effect. The growth rate versus mass at one cell cycle stage in S phase. It has this dip, and either way you measure it here. And you can sort of see this here at stage 4, which is somewhere in G1. There's really essentially no correlation, but in stage 7 there's some correlation. It's not very strong, about 0.2. All right, so now if you inhibit the mTOR pathway, it has a big effect by controlling the by making the size control in G1 much stronger, but it doesn't have much effect on the S phase one. So there are at least two different types of size control mechanisms, one mediated by mTOR and one not mediated by mTOR. I will skip this for a moment. So we can try to do something about and ask, well, what's happening here? Size control could be happening because cells are synthesizing protein more slowly, or it could be they're degrading protein more rapidly. And what we find is that that the growth rate dips at this point in the cell cycle when we add normally, but if we add cyclohexamide, that wipes out this second dip in the cell cycle. So this seems to be a process which is affected by protein synthesis. On the other hand, degradation also has a big effect. In fact, it has a much bigger effect because, as you see here, if we look at just the growth rate versus mass, that function, which normally would dip here in a normal case, and that dip is affected, as I showed by rapamycin, is dramatically affected by blocking just a little bit. These are not full blocks. These are maybe 30 to 40% slowdown of protein degradation. It has a big effect there. So we think that that there are two effects that are happening in this S phase regulation. But a big part of that effect is probably due to changes in rate of protein degradation. And they are really causing big cells to grow less quickly and therefore correcting the overall size variation in the population. So I think that, that this is sort of an odd field because there are very few people working in it. There's some people working in yeast on this problem. They've focused on mostly on cell cycle length, cell cycle regulation. But we find in mammalian cells, the largest effect is not on cell cycle regulation, although we can see an effect on cell cycle regulation, but actually on differential growth between large and small cells. And that happens only at a couple of points in the cell cycle. So there's a major transition in S phase, whereby cells measure their size, and also in G1, and correct this variation by controlling their growth rate. Another transition in G1 depends on mTOR, so it may be primarily also affecting protein synthesis rate. Both protein synthesis control and protein degradation play a role in size control in S phase. And so the next experimental challenge is to be able to measure protein synthesis and degradation in real time during the cell cycle as a function of cell cycle. And this is another kind of experimental dilemma how to do that. I just want to give you a look into the future of how to do that. And that is by something called stimulated Raman microscopy. So Raman microscopy measures is a scattering vibrational mode, not scattering, of a molecule that's used a lot in organic chemistry as a means of looking at differences. And it's particularly easy to measure the CH Raman band, absorption band, and the CD, deuterium versus hydrogen. So you can take cells growing in a culture and then replace the amino acids, some set of amino acids, like we use valine, leucine, isoleucine, those three amino acids, with say deuterated valine, deuterated lysine, leucine, and do a pulse chase, and then measure the incorporation in real time of the deuterium into the cells and measure protein synthesis that way. And also, you can measure protein degradation similarly by washing it out and seeing how things change in a washout experiment. That turns out to be impossible to do by standard Raman microscopy. So Sunny Ji and others, who's a very fine physical chemist at Harvard Chemistry Department, has developed something called stimulated Raman microscopy, where you pump they're not really electrons, but it's their phonons up to another imaginary state, which I don't fully understand this process completely, but you populate that state very heavily by this pumping mechanism, which makes it easier to visualize the absorption of the of light in that wave at that wavelength. And again, deuterium is different from hydrogen, so it increases the magnitude of the effect. And as a result, you can actually measure the incorporation of amino acids into proteins over time. And I would propose we did it with autoradiography, and the woman, Shirley Lee in the lab, was so opposed to using autoradiography as a method for doing this laborious method, that instead she took an even more laborious method and made it work, of course. And we get, we also get spatial resolved looks at where proteins are put in the cell, but that we haven't used that information. And there are a few people from the Sunny Ji's lab, these two people, and Sunin as well, who helped develop this method, and we use it for other purposes, for being able to distinguish very easily because of the chemistry differences between fats, carbohydrates, proteins. So we can actually look at mass increases, not just in proteins, but also in lipids in cells. And I think it has some very interesting applications in differentiated cells. As I said, the spectrum of D-leucine is different from the spectrum of BSA. So we use this particular band for measurement. And this is kind of what we can see. We can see the incorporation as a function of time. And we're now just at the point of making use of this method to measure protein synthesis rates and degradation rates in the cell cycle. And we'll be able to say, not just using drug inhibition and saying, well, it seems something to have to do with mTOR as protein synthesis, or cyclohexamide may be protein degradation, bortezomib, or, you know, proteasome inhibitor has to do with degradation. We'll directly measure protein synthesis and degradation. All right, I'm just going to just say at this point that I know this was a laborious story, only to end up with a fairly simple point at the end, but the point was not clear, and it wasn't agreed upon, and there's some things that weren't even anticipated. So first of all, there is something non-trivial about how growing cells maintain their size. It's not simply that they do compensate with drugs and effects and conditions and nutrients to try to keep cell size the same, but fundamentally, they maintain their cell size as they grow through the cell division cycle by measuring their size in some manner and tweaking their growth rate in some manner so that the larger cells now grow more slowly and the smaller cells now grow more rapidly. The larger cells progress through the cell cycle more rapidly. And so those two effects together mean that the variance changes not at all over time. It precisely maintains the variance in the population. These perturbations occur only at specific times in the cell cycle, and not throughout the cell cycle. And as far as we know, these things are going to be present in all cell types. Okay, that's sort of what it's a new phenomenon to study. So we're at the point, I think, where the phenomenon is almost well enough defined, that we can now do the things that most molecular biologists are happy to do, you know, and that is to try to, you know, knock things down and overexpress things and make mutations and look at different cell types and try to understand what kind of mechanism is being used to sense the size of a cell and to regulate its growth at these transitions. But that said, I've been interested so far only in growing cells. But in some ways, the most spectacular growth rate regulation occurs in non-growing cells. And I think the methods here, some of them I think are applicable to studies in living tissues. And I think we now have a way of to look at the size of cells in tissues, to look at their mass, protein mass independently, and to look at their lipid composition or their lipid mass independently. And even though these are simple measures, they are the products of all the metabolic control and differentiation control that we're all very happy with. And I didn't go into this, but one place where we have applied this to is in chondrocyte development, where in fact size control is essentially the whole basis by which bones grow. That chondrocytes get bigger, and it's not their proliferation, but it's their hypertrophy, which is in fact controlling bone growth. So I think it's a very interesting area. I want to just thank some people. I'm just going to talk about this. So I start with the people who've been involved in this project heavily over the years. Amit, who got started on this project when we thought it was simple. And then Miriam Ginsberg, who's now in Toronto, Ron Coffrey, who's in Toronto, Julie Liu, who's a postdoc in my lab, Sunny Ji, who's our collaborator in chemistry at Harvard, Dan Fu was at Harvard, is now at the University of Washington, Scott Manalis is an engineer, and Sumano is now at UC Berkeley. So not all these people are international, that's very common in science these days. It's heavily, you know, been influenced by chemistry. It's also, more importantly, been heavily influenced by chemistry and engineering. And I think the problem ultimately was one of measurement. And I think without those insights that people came up with to how to measure things, we wouldn't have a well-defined problem to study. Thank you.